Greetings, this is another video overview by the flashlight reviewer Selfbuilt. I have here in front of me a late engineering sample of a new light from Niwalker, the MM18. This is part of the MiniMax Nova family, and I previously reviewed the MM15, which was a 2xMT-G2 light. This new model, the MM18, is a bit interesting. You can see right from the beginning it has dual switches, and the reason for that is it has a number of different types of emitters. So you'll see, I'll just sort of get you to focus here at the top for a moment. Those are two MKR emitters from Cree. If I can maybe close up a little bit more, it's going to be hard to sort of get the camera to autofocus here. But you can probably see there's a grid arrangement under the dome. There's actually four emitters that are sort of brought together, kind of like the old MCEs, if you remember that model from Cree. So you basically have four emitters that are brought together to give you one high output emitter. So this is sort of a competitor to the MTG2s that were used in the other model, again, all made by Cree. These ones are a cool white emitter, fairly high output, although not quite as high as the MTG2s, which were neutral white emitters. But they still give you a pretty good beam pattern because the four dyes are fairly close together. You can see there's two, both in very shallow well reflectors, which kind of reminds you, I have here in front of me actually the old MM15 as well, just to sort of compare. You can see in at least the top part, you get sort of two shallow reflectors again for the two sort of higher output emitters, even sort of smaller reflectors this time. But the interesting feature, if I bring it along this way, is you can see there's also a very deep reflector with a standard XML2. So what you have right there is a cool white XML2 reflector at the base of a fairly deep smooth reflector. And you have this combination. So the way this works is the two switches control independently. The switch on the left controls the XML2 emitter, and I have it on its lowest setting. The switch on the right controls the MKR emitters, again on the lowest setting, so you can see what they look like. So you can control the two independently, and you can combine them. You can have them both on at the same time. You can have them set to different levels. The point of this is it gives you a nice mix between choosing between throw through the 1xML2 emitter and just high output flood through the two MKR emitters. Now I know it's hard to see all that with all the reflections here in my office, but so I'll run through the beam in a moment. Before I do, just I guess a few comments about interface. The overall interface is very similar to the original MM15, and in fact so is the build. You can see there's a tripod attachment point there. Overall look is similar. There's a handle on both these models that attaches right below the switch. The switch on the MM15 was a bit harder to access in a way. It was very flat. There wasn't much identification except, of course, for that N logo that would light up. But it was still a very flat switch. What you see on the MM18 is these are raised switches. As you can probably see a bit there, if I just sort of angle it a little bit. They're raised and they're rubberized, so there's a tactile grip difference. So if you run your finger over the light, you can find them easier. I mean, they're still not completely easy to find. Kind of reminds me a bit of some of the Nightcore switches. They are distinctive, though, because of the rubberized feel. And you can see there's the same sort of green LED that lights up beneath them, flashing once every 3 seconds to let you know you're in standby mode. The interface is very similar but revised a little bit on the individual switches. So if I start with the switch on the left, which controls the XML2 emitter, click once to turn it on. This is the lowest setting, which I usually call lowest. If you press and hold the switch, it cycles up. So there's low, there's medium, high, and higher, as I would call them, and then back down to the lowest setting. So there are five output levels controlled by a press and hold of the switch. At any time, when the light is on, of course, you get a constant green as you did before. You can double click the switch to jump to turbo. A single click takes you back to the regular mode. So at any time, double click, and up we go to turbo mode. If you double click again, you'll get a strobe mode. Double click again, you have an SOS mode. Again, you get a beacon mode. So it's a flash every few seconds or so. Now, if I take a single click, we'll come back to the regular outputs. There's mode memory, so if you advance, let's say, to a certain output level and turn the light off, turn it back on, it comes back on in the last mode that you memorized it to. Now, just again, a comment about how the switch feel works here. You press and hold to cycle, you click to turn off. One thing that's a little bit different now is if you do one click to turn on, if you double click to turbo, if you want to turn the light off, you have to single-click once to go back to the memorized regular mode, then single-click again to turn the light off. So that can take a little getting used to. The function is the same, although controlled independently on the other switches. You can see the low output. You can press and hold, so lower, low, medium, high, and higher. And then back to low. Double-click for turbo, which, as you can tell, is quite bright. Same kind of thing. Click once, come back down to the regular mode, and then you come back on. So what's kind of interesting about this is you could set any sort of combination of levels. You could set like a low flood. You can then turn on the main throw beam with a bit of flood. You could even max that out. You could put that into strobe. You could put this one into strobe, or you could put this one back to off, back to a lower level. Just turn, let's say, one of them on strobe, on a beacon, and you can also control the output of this one. So you have a lot of very independent controls of what you want to do with the light, probably more than you actually need, but it gives you an idea of what you want to do. It can make it a bit confusing if you're trying to figure out where you are to turn things off. You got to remember that you have to say, if you're in one of the double click modes, you got to single click back to the regular modes and then single click again to turn off. So that's a little bit different from the earlier light. As always, there's going to be a standby drain when you're in this mode. You can disable this, and you can also disable the switch from accidental activation by triple clicking the switch from off. You get a brief flash, and then the light will no longer illuminate, and you will no longer be having a standby current. Except, as you just saw, it's still showing one, because I have to lock out both switches if I really want to do this. So, three times on both switches. Now the light gets locked out, and there's no longer the green flash. The green flash draws a certain amount of battery current. You'll see in my full review for details. So if you really want to spare your batteries over the long term, you're better to lock out the light. But you have to remember you have to lock out both emitters separately. You unlock the emitters by a triple click of the switch. But since I've locked them both out, all that will do now is it'll let me turn on the XML2 emitter. You still can't turn on the other one. See, there's still no light coming out until you triple click the switch again, and you're back on. So a little bit more cumbersome because of the dual switch arrangement. They really do function completely independently. That gives you more opportunities to how you want to customize the light, but it also means you got to get used to the difference effects in the beam. Now, to show you what it looks like, let's turn on. So there's the lowest setting of the throwy beam. I'll just press and hold here. We'll ramp it back up to the various levels so you can see what it looks like. And again, double click jumps you to the turbo mode. So you can see it's a fairly typical kind of throwy beam. You get a fairly typical spill. One comment, you can see there's a few distortions in the spill in this area over here. And that has to do with how the light kind of moves into the overlapping wells for the MKR emitters. So it's something to keep in mind. But it's a very minor kind of effect, and you won't really see it at greater distances. You get a pretty good throwy beam with a pretty wide corona, is how I would describe it. So it's a reasonably good thrower. It's just something to keep in mind. It's nice to have that extra option for throw, something the original MM15 didn't have. If I turn this one off for the moment, and then just turn on these ones again, so you can see up close, and I'll just cycle through, just pull it back out again, you can kind of see, and I'll double click. You can see how bright this is on turbo mode. Again, my camera's auto-adjusting, so it's kind of hard to get a really good feel. Some of the changes you're seeing are just the camera working its magic. But again, if I just kind of cycle kind of quickly, you'll see as it at least tries to up, and go through the various levels. So very bright beam, very high output. And again, the nice thing is that you can bring them both up. So if we bring this up to a nice kind of reasonably high level, let the camera auto adjust, and now I'll just turn on the throw beam, and you can see the effect. So it's quite an interesting sort of effect to have them both on. You can get a lot of flow, a lot of flood in the near ground, and you can get a lot of throw for the distance. So kind of an interesting arrangement. As before, inside the cells have a spring there in the circuit board in the head, and they mount onto this kind of contact board at the base. They're on four struts. You can use flat top cells because there's an indentation there on the button. Here I'm just using unprotected higher capacity IMR cells. One thing that's a little bit different is that they have a little cover. Before, you had the four exposed screws for each of the struts. You may actually need to take this off if you ever have problems with connections. Sometimes I find these screws can loosen underneath, and if that's the case, they can push back from the strut due to the pressure of the batteries, especially if you use really tall, long batteries. If that happens, you have to sort of retighten them, which is why you might want to need to take that cover off. But I guess they put it on to prevent the risk of, you know, accidental shorting. Otherwise, the light looks very much, you know, as before on the MM15. The handle attaches as before. In case you want to see what it looks like with the handle attached, I have here an earlier engineering sample they sent me for testing. Physically, it looks exactly the same, so you can now just see what happens if you put the handle on. You can carry it by the handle, but typically I recommend you don't do that. You're better to hold it by the body of the light. Your hand will provide a bit of natural sort of heat dissipation through your own circulatory system, but it's also a better way for you to gauge the heat of the light and whether or not it's running too hot. So just a point to keep in mind, I recommend you don't actually use the handle. You can see that the handle comes with a case with its own little Allen key, the extra screws. They give you an extra sticky felt pad there as well. It also comes with a very nice compartment for holding the light. Lots of different, features inside. Lots of little pockets where you can store extra things. Lots of, you know, tightening bands, the whole nine yards. You know, little pockets you can open up, and of course the main pocket area where you can stash the light along with extra things. So quite a nice versatile. Kind of reminds me of some of the Maxpedition type, you know, bags. Pretty good quality. Maybe not quite as high as some of the Maxpedition ones, but, you know, a similar kind of idea and style that you can attach, you know, in many ways to many different things to hold it all together. So kind of a nice little extra package. I don't know what the rest of retail packaging will look like, but I'm sure it'll be similar to the other Niwalker lights. Now, I know that was a fairly sort of long review. Hopefully you found the overview helpful. For more information on how the light performs, including, you know, run times, beam shots, and so forth, please see my full review at Candle Power Forums. You'll find me in the review forum under the username selfbuilt or off my personal website at flashlightreviews.ca. Thanks for your time. Hope you found that useful.